Okay, so I am back with another video. Gonna be doing the same thing I did yesterday. I believe I wore this yesterday too. But I got a comment on my last video saying that they wanted like a Q&A video. And first of all, if I would just like to say thank you for the comments. But I also, I didn't know like what this video or channel was going to be. I also was just going to be posting randomly, literally randomly, like whenever I wanted. And my goal was to not edit videos because I think 2 years ago I tried to start a channel. I posted one video and then I had to edit it. And it took like 2 weeks to edit a video. So, if I am going to be uploading videos, I'm not going to edit them. So, yeah. But I guess a little bit about me. Sorry, I don't know if you can hear the noise, but I'm not going to edit that out because I don't know how to edit. But my name's Caroline. Favorite animal is a deer. I like deer. Not to eat. Just, I like deer. I'm a senior in high school. Kind of like the worst year to be a senior because of COVID and you're not in school. But I also kind of like being at home. I have two dogs. They're both labs. One chocolate and one black. They're really nice. I like Marvel. I like Star Wars. I like Maze Runner series. I like to watch movies and shows. And I don't like to read. That is why I am reading. So, I guess let's start. The last time I placed this, it made a loud noise, so I don't know. I'm gonna try and, like, I don't know if that, like, worked. But we're going to be reading the same book I was yesterday. But I'm going to be reading chapter 18. Sorry. It's called The Forest as Water Pump. How does water get back to the forest? Anyway, or to take one step back, further back, how does water reach land at all? Seems like such a simple question, but the answers turn out to be rather complicated. For one of the essential characteristics of land is that it is higher than gravity. Gravity causes water to flow down that to the lowest point, which should cause the continent to dry out. The only reason this doesn't happen is thanks to supplies of water constantly dropped off by clouds, which forms over the ocean and are blown over land by the wind. However, the mechanism only functions within a few hundred miles of the coast. The further inland you go, the drier it is, because the clouds get rained out and disappear. When you go about 400 miles from the coast, it is so dry that the first desert appears. If we depend on just this mechanism of water for water, life would be possible only in a narrow band around the edge of the continent. The interior of the land masses would be arid and bleak, so thank goodness for trees. Of all the plants, trees have the largest surface area covered in leaves. For every square yard of forest, 27 square yards of leaves and needles blanket the crown. Part of every rainfall is interpreted in the canopy and immediately evaporates again. In addition, each summer, trees use, oh my god, what happened to my voice? And, oh my god, can they like stop talking? Why do I sound like this? Okay, I guess we're gonna whisper this. In addition, each summer, trees use up to 8,500 cubic yards of water per square unit, which they release into the air through transpiration. This water vapor creates new clouds that travel thousands of miles inland as they are in the coast. There are few requirements for the pump to work from the ocean to the farthest corner. There must be forest, and most importantly, the coastal forests are the foundation for this system. If they do not exist, the system falls apart. Scientists credit Anastasia Markgreva from St. Petersburg. Trees make sure that the raindrops don't land heavily on the ground. freshwater snails call home. And here, they enjoy their preferred temperature year-round. And it's not only the forest floor that makes this possible. In summer, a microhabitat like this could warm up quickly and avoid the snail. But the leafy canopy throws shadows that block out most of the sun. The forest offers a similar and even more important surface to streams. The water in a stream is susceptible to greater temperature variations than spring water, which is continuously replaced with cool groundwater. These streams contain animals such as salamanders, larvae, and tadpoles, which are just waiting for their life outside the stream to begin. Like the freshwater snail, they need the water to remain cool so that the action doesn't escape. But if the water freezes solid, the baby salamanders will die. It's a good thing deciduous trees just happen to solve this problem. In winter, when there is very little warmth in the sun, bare branches allow a lot of warmth to penetrate. The movement of water over the uneven bottom also protects the stream from suddenly freezing. When the sun climbs higher in the sky in late spring and the air is noticeably warmer, the trees unfold their leaves, closing and shading the running water. Then in the fall, when temperatures drop once again, the sky reopens above the streams. When the trees drop all their leaves, it's tougher for streams that flow under coniferous trees. It's bitterly cold here in winter, and sometimes the water freezes solid because it warms up only gradually in the spring. This habitat is just not an option for many organisms. But pitch dark streams like this are rarely found in nature because spruce don't like having wet feet and therefore usually keep their distance. It's most often plantations that causes conflict between coniferous forests and the denizens of streams. The importance of trees for streams continue even after death. When a dead beech falls across a stream bed, it lies where it's decades. It lies there for decades. It acts like a small dam and creates tiny pockets of calm water. Species that can't tolerate strong currents just hang out. The nondescript larvae of the fire salamander are just such creatures. They look like small newts. Newts, maze runner. Except they have feathery gills. They are finely stippled with dark markings and a yellow spot where their legs meet to their bodies. In the cold water of the forest, they lie in wait for the tiny crawfish to eat. These little guys need crystal clear water, and the dead trees look after this as well. Mud and floating debris drop to the bottom of the tiny dammed pools, and because streams flow are so low, it gives bacteria more time to break down harmful substances. Don't worry about that foam that sometimes forms in these pools after every rain. What looks like an environmental disaster is facts that result in humic acids. The tiny waterfalls has mixed with air until they've turned into froth. These acids come from the decomposition of leaves and dead wood and are extremely beneficial for the ecosystem. When it comes to the creation of small pools, forests in the Central Europe have become less dependent on dead trees falling down. They are increasingly getting help from an animal that has recently made a comeback after being nearly eradicated. This animal is the beaver. I have many doubts whether the trees are really happy about this. For this rodent, which can lay more than 60 pounds, dang, is a lumberjack of the animal world. It takes a beaver one night to bring down a 3 to 4 inch thick tree. Large trees are felled over the course of multiple work shifts. What the beaver is after are twigs and small branches, which is used for food. Oh, I didn't know that. It stockpiles enormous qualities in its lodge to last for the winter, and as the years pass, the lodge grows by many yards. The branches also camouflage the entrance of the tunnel that lead into the lodge. As an added security feature, the beavers build these entrances underwater so that predators can't get in. The rest of the living space is above water and therefore dry. Because water levels fluctuate wildly with the seasons, many beavers also build dams, blocking streams and turning them into large ponds. Beaver ponds slow the flow of the water from the forest, and extensive wetlands form in the areas around the dams. Alders and willows like to grow here. Beeches positive influence overall by regulating water supplies. And while they're at it, they provide a habitat for species that adapt to large areas with standing water. So, as we close this chapter, let's return once again to the source of the water in the rainforest. In the forest, rain. Rain can put you in the most wonderful mood while you're walking. But if you are not wearing the right clothes, it can be unpleasant. If you live in Europe, mature deciduous trees offer a very special service to you. A short-term weather forecast brought to you by chaffinches. I don't know what that means. These rust red birds with gray heads normally sing a song whose rhythm ornithologists like to transcribe as chip chip chip. I started doing soft spoken and then it got too loud, so I moved the mic and I talked in whisper. Oh my god, what? Can this book close, please? So that is it for today. Thank you so much, and hopefully I'll be here tomorrow and I'll read chapter 19.